Good morning. Let me try it again. Good morning. Hey, that was much better the second time around. Y'all are quick learners. I tell you what, that was awesome. Good deal. All right, well, it's good to see everybody here this morning. Hope everybody's had a great week, enjoyed their 4th of July with their family and fireworks and all that good stuff. Today's a special day. We're going to have here in a little bit the mission team that went to Guatemala. We're going to speak about our trip there and some of the experiences and things and how God used us and worked through us and the things that he was able to bless us with as far as, you know, things that we got out of it. And so we're going to see a video about that here in a little bit, and we'll talk some more about that here in a little bit. But if you would please stand and join us as we sing Glorious Day.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who would carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn till I met you. You called my name and I ran out of that grave.
Good hand. Amen. God bless you guys. You be seated this morning. Man, it is so good to be back home. Thank you guys for praying for us and asking the Lord to bless us. We had a great 2 or 3 weeks just kind of resting and relaxing and reviewing some things in our life. I got a new hairdo. How about that? I went and got all my hair cut off, and now I can't comb it. So I just had to. So somebody said, you look like somebody on TV, the evangelist, something like anyhow. So I just did it the best I could, all right? Hey, it's good to be back home. Thank you all guys for praying for me. Hey, thank Pastor Kip for the great job he did while I was gone. Amen. Pastor Kip, he's out there in the foyer. He did a super job. I got to watch y'all first Sunday. I was at Cornerstone Baptist Church in a little place called Ridge City, South Dakota. And it was pretty interesting. Then I actually came back about a week early, Sunday week ago. I was down in Russellville, Tharptown Baptist Church. And then last week I was at Woodmont, so I got to go out and just look around and do some things. And so, again, thank y'all for praying for us. Hey, there's a lot in the bulletin. Again, in just a moment, you're going to be hearing from our team that got to go to Guatemala about what God did down there, building the house and things of that nature. So you can look at that. Hey, kids' camp is right around the corner. Be praying for that and asking the Lord to bless that. And thank God for all the people being baptized out of Vacation Bible School. So we're just seeing the hand of God do a lot, and we appreciate that very, very much. Again, as we go forward, we're asking the Lord to lead. Hey, in just a moment, we're going to have prayer. I want to remind you to pray for Chris Sapp. They put Chris back in the hospital this morning. He's back at ICU. So pray for he and Miss Judy and ask the Lord to bless them. Is that right, Brother Brad? So things are, anyhow, just pray for them and ask God to bless and to be with them. And I know there are others. Miss Smith's here this morning. She gave her husband Grady back to Jesus about 3 weeks ago. And so we're certainly praying for her and her family and Morgan family. And so, and Miss Stella Jones went to be with the Lord last week, did her funeral and last Wednesday, and pray for that family. So we've had a lot going on. So ask the Lord to be with them today, okay? We're glad you're here. If you're our guest on campus today, we're extremely happy that you're here. Church, would you praise God for all of our guests today? Amen. God bless you. And just a minute, we want to let you know that. And again, being back next week, we'll kind of get back to a regular routine for us preaching. I hope I can still preach. I said, after missing that much, I don't know that I can still do it, but we're going to do our best, okay? So I'm excited to do that. Hey, let's pray, and then I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. Father, we love you, and we certainly pray for our families who've gone through the valley of the shadow of death, and they've given their husbands and loved ones and moms back to Jesus. And so we pray for them today, God. They're missing somebody that they love dearly, and their life's a little different. So I pray for grace and mercy that you'd be with them. Pray for Chris Sapp today, and I know there are others. It's so good to have Joy and Ed Adams in the service today. God, continue to bless Ed and strengthen him and give Miss Joy the physical strength she needs to do all the things that they're going through. Again, thank you for our guests. Most of all, we look forward to hearing what you did in Guatemala, and bless that now in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, do me a favor. Would you stand, please? Shake 2 or 3 hands right where you are. We're going to sing a couple more songs, and then we'll hear from our team, okay?
Got a story too good to hide. I was a blind man wandering till I saw the light. Yeah, I got a story I can't deny. I'm a living, breathing miracle, and I just gotta testify. Ain't nobody love me like you. Ain't nobody love me this good. Ain't nobody love me like Jesus. And I know, nobody could. Tell me who can give me this freedom. Tell me who can give me this far. nobody love me like Jesus. And I know, nobody could. Now I'm anointed to bring the news. Yeah, everything he did for me, I know he'll do for you. He gave me joy for the morning, for the ashes of ground. Yeah, I'm a walking, talking miracle, and I just gotta let it out. Ain't nobody love me like Jesus. Ain't nobody love me this good. Ain't nobody love me like Jesus. And I know, nobody could. Tell me who can give me this freedom. Tell me who can get me this far. Ain't nobody love me like Jesus. And I know, nobody could. Nobody could pull me from the darkness. Save me by the blood and raise me from the ashes. And I know, nobody could break off every shackle and tear down every wall and set free every captive. And I know, nobody could. Ain't nobody love me like Jesus. Ain't nobody love me this good. Love me like Jesus, and I know nobody could. Tell me who can give me this freedom. Tell me who can give me this far. Ain't nobody love me like Jesus, and I know nobody could. Nobody could, and I know nobody.
Amazing grace.
shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior is ransomed me.
I just thank you so much for this day that you've given us. God, we're just so thankful for this opportunity to be able to come to your house and praise your holy name. God, we're just so humbled by how amazing you are. We're just so humbled and thankful for that amazing grace. God, because we know that you didn't have to do what you did. You didn't have to send your only son to come down here and die and take the place and hang on that cross that was meant for us. But you did it anyway. And we just praise you for that. And God, we also praise you for all the ways that you work in our life that we may not see from day to day. Because God, we know that you're working in each one of our lives and you want us to be prosperous. And God, we know that there's a lot of things that goes on behind the scenes that you're doing for us, and we just thank you for that too. And I pray that you just be with the rest of the service. I pray that everything that's said and done here on this stage today will be for your honor and glory. And I pray that for somebody here today or somebody listening at home, I pray that their life will be touched by something that's said here today, and I pray that you just use each one of us as speaking for your honor and glory, and I pray that you just use us as your instrument to reach those. And I just thank you so much for Jesus dying on the cross. Please forgive my sins. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
For you to do, and your hand is moving right now. You are still showing up at the tomb of every Lazarus, and your voice is calling me out. And right now I know you're able, and my you never lost a battle. No, you never lost a battle. And right now.
Harmon, on behalf of Hands of Hope International and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we present you the keys to your new house.
Good morning. Ah, wonderful. So as you can tell, we had a pretty good time. We are glad to be home. I know it was, I don't know if you guys could tell or not, but it was raining on us every day. So first of all, I'd like to say thank you to First Baptist Church Center Star, every one of you guys, for praying for us. We had a very successful trip, a safe trip. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for financial support and just overall support in general. Thank you very, very much. Because without you guys, we couldn't have been able to do it. I know Brother Eric and Miss Amanda also say thank you very much on behalf of Hands of Hope International. Thank you for all the support that you give them in the ministry. And they're doing great and mighty things over there every day on a daily basis. And we got to see just a little bit of what we got to experience our week in Guatemala. It was a wonderful week. And guys, more than anything else, we went over there. You know, we'll go over there. We want to, you know, share the gospel, and we want to make a big impact. But I think most of all, I think every one of them will agree that I think we get changed. Our life changes more, I think, than the people that we go and minister to, just because we come back a different person, seeing God work on a daily basis over there. What those people have versus what we have, it kind of makes us appreciate our blessings from God a little bit more every day. So thank you again for your support. So today we've got our team up here who went over with us. We got to have 7 days over there, had a really good time. You got to see some of the things we got to do over there. Daily outreach, bunk beds, we built a house, rice bags, jump ropes. We did a whole lot of things over there. It was a busy, 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 busy week. We started every morning, got up about 7, 7:30, ate breakfast. We left the mission house every morning at 9 o'clock in the morning, and we didn't get back usually until about 9 o'clock at night. So it was a very, very busy day. And if you guys know anything about Guatemala, the traffic in Guatemala is a standstill. It takes about an hour and a half based on traffic to get to our villages that we go and reach. And also one of the days that we were planning on hiking the active volcano, the week that we were there, they had a sinkhole, and so it shut the road down over to Pacaya, which is the volcano that we were going to go hike, so we didn't get a chance because it would have been a five-hour drive to get to the volcano, so we had to skip that. But anyway, today I've just asked the team if they would just kind of share a little bit what they got to witness over there, more than anything else, where they saw God show up and how it impacted their life the most. And before I do that, one thing we do need for next year, and I'm going to go ahead and put it out there now so we have a whole year. So I was there additional week, and we had a medical team came in, and I know VBS, they in the back or something, Maria and that group, they collected reading glasses and shoes. And our medical team, the week after we left, I was still there. We had over about 200 pairs of shoes. The very first day, we gave them all out. And you should have seen the response of those ladies' face to get a brand new pair of shoes. So it was wonderful. So I'm going to go ahead and ask and put that out there. If you have extra shoes that back to school's coming up in a month and you buy your kids some new shoes and you want to donate your old shoes, we could definitely use them for next year. We'll be going over there again next year for a medical trip and also a regular trip, but we're going to try to get 1,000 pairs of shoes, okay? And right now we have four of the churches that have joined us, so if we could just do 200, 250 here at CenterStar, then we'd reach that goal. And it'd be, you'd be amazing. Some people, the shoes they have are either worn out or they don't have shoes at all. So just put that in the back of your mind. Reading glasses and shoes. They don't have to be new. Just as long as they're not wore out. Okay, guys, that's all we ask. You can just bring them up here to the church, donate them, and we'll be more than happy to collect them and take them over there with us. So, anyhow, just let them share. I don't want to talk anymore. So, just to tell you who's on the team, you guys probably know everybody, but I know some people that sit on the left-hand side don't know the people that sit on the right-hand side, and the right-hand side people don't know who sit on the left-hand side. So, we got Christian and Katie. That's our youth guys. And we've got Seth Walton. We got Ashley Howell. Ashley and Coy went. Coy's on. Is he coming? There's Coy. How you doing, buddy? There's Coy. And then their two daughters went also, Emma and Hagen, but they're not here today with us. And then we got Taylor, Hunter, Sarah. Everybody knows Josh, the Greg family, Landon. We've got Olivia Chappelle and Mary Nolan. All right. So we had a total, and I'm sorry, we took Canyon with us. How old was he? 14 months? 14 months. And he learned to what? They learned to walk in Guatemala. So pretty awesome. So, yeah. So, anyway, guys, with that being said, I'll just ask them. I'm just going to turn it over and let them share what they saw, how God impacted their life, what was the difference between America and then, and also what they brought back to the state. So we'll start out with Christian.
Yeah. So I'm going to try to keep my cool. Even that video was a little much. I was like, why are we watching this before? I didn't want to be a crybaby up here this whole time. But just a quick story that I wanted to share just to show how God was able to bless us while we were out there. So, like you said, we brought Canyon with us. He was 14 months old. So, and, you know, we weren't at the house build every day doing anything like that. So, we got to, me and Katie got to mainly focus on going out to house visits. So, what that looks like is, you know, going out to, they are translators that know the village. They go out there. So, we go out to places they've never been. They just start knocking on doors, and then they'll just open up and they'll just invite you in your house. And it could be the first day, it was just me, Katie, and Canyon, and our translator were in our little group. So we were going into homes, and people are just so welcoming, just invite you in. But, you know, the whole purpose that we're doing that is to, you know, first to be there to share the love of God, to give them hope, but, you know, to also share the gospel, you know, see if they're connected in any way to a church, if they know who Jesus is, you know, all that good stuff, to be there for them. If they have a relationship, how can we pray for you? How can we be there for you? And so, you know, that's your mindset that, you know, that it's just going to be a lot of us, you know, just trying to meet their needs. And one of the houses the first day we went to, we climbed up this huge hill. Had Canyon on my back. We're going up these mountains, doing it all. And we go into these people's house, and so we just get to talking, and they actually, this family, a really solid family, a husband, a wife, they live there with their daughter and her daughter and their daughter's kids. And they said, yeah, we're involved in a church. The father actually plays piano at the church. They're very involved. You know, just a good Christian home that we got to be there for and to witness. And as we just are asking how we can pray for them and just conversation with them, they also just started pouring into us saying, hey, we want to pray for y'all. We want to pray for the rest of your time here. Know that God is always with you. God will always provide for you. You know, just really encouraging us. And it was really special to see how, of course, anyone who's ever been involved in ministry, being in ministry, now this is my first time ever doing it, but now going on, I guess it's been 2 years now, you know, just in ministry for the first time, figuring it all out. You can start to be a little hard on yourself, but you can be a little discouraged, and just to know that God saw my heart in that, to know that, hey, Christian, I know that you're going out to Guatemala to go and, you know, give this hope, to share this gospel, to meet these people's needs, but here, you and Katie and Canyon, it was just us, I'm going to put you right here, knock on this door to meet this family. So that way they could be there to lift us up. And, you know, just to see that as we were praying, just to hear all of them just praying in unison together with us, just lifting us up and just being such an encouragement. It was such a blessing. And it's exactly what God knew that I needed, just that encouragement while we were out there. So that was a huge blessing for me. And now to take it back to it, you know, what did you bring home with you? How are you go to Guatemala? All's great. And our verse for the week that we kind of went over a lot was Jeremiah 29:13, I think. And it's, you'll find me when you seek me with all of your heart. And of course, when you're out there and you're on the, you know, on in a foreign country with a group of people, with a team, that your main focus, you're seeking God with everything you do. You're going out there. You have a mission, right? We know that we're going out there. Jesus is at the center of everything you're doing. And, you know, you can feel that spirit moving when everyone is seeking him with all your heart. And then you come back, you get in your back, you know, your alarm goes off for work. You got to get ready. You get dressed. You go to work. You come back home from work. You get dinner ready. You go, you know, just that monotonous, you know, that schedule that we get into. And I was like, God, I don't want to just come back here and say, wow, God, you did great things in Guatemala. I felt you there. And now I'm back here, and it's like, oh, and now back to normal, you know. But really just taking heart that if you are seeking God with all of your heart, that's when you're going to find him. So how we can, you know, this is for all of us, for all of our mission team, for me especially, you know, how am I going to be able to seek God with all of my heart and all of these regular things we're doing, you know? I need to be seeing an impact of, if I'm seeking God with all my heart, my family should look different. If I'm seeking God with all my heart, my workplace should look different. If I'm seeking God with all my heart, my church life should look different. I should be impacting my church. So that was something that I really took home for me. You know, God, help me to seek you with all my heart, not just when I'm being super intentional in Guatemala. That's great and that's easy, but, you know, it's really that discipline to come back and say, okay, God, still seeking with all of my heart, but it's going to look a little different, you know, and just trying to incorporate that now to continue to live that intentional life. It was really the encouragement I needed. So thank you all so much again for the financial support, the prayers. It really blessed our family to go on that trip. So thank you.
Hello. So the biggest thing for me was that I brought Kenyon on this trip, and I know a lot of y'all probably thought we were crazy because he's 14 months old and we took him to a foreign country, and I know my mom didn't like it, but let me just say that it was worth it 100 times over. Going into the trip, my biggest prayer was like, God, please just let it be worth it, even a little inch of anything be worth it, because it was a big thing to prep for, and I overthink everything. I overprepare for everything. Like, I'm a first-time mom, so it was a lot going into it, and I truly just was like, let it be worth one little thing, because I feel like I'm not going to sleep. I'm not going to get to participate in anything the way that everyone will get to do, and God blessed us 10 times over that Kenyon was truly a perfect little angel the whole time we were there. It was way colder than we were expecting. It was raining the whole time. It was a lot harder than I was expecting. It wasn't a perfect scenario for a baby by any means. And he did amazing. He was a trooper. And God just met us where we were and let us still be blessed in it. And the house that we went to, or really every house, everyone was obsessed with Kenyon. And it truly just gave us such an opportunity to talk about our kids. Everywhere we went, everywhere that I got to go, pretty much there was a baby about the age that he was, and it just really let my heart open up to the mom from that perspective, and it gave me a huge perspective shift of the things that I get frustrated about here as a mom, or just overwhelmed about, getting caught up in the mundane of being a stay-at-home mom. Like, their mundane is so different and challenging. And so being able to see that perspective and also get to, you know, give them hope that, you know, they're doing a good job, they're doing the best that they can, and that God will meet them there too, was a really big blessing. But one thing that I got to do while we were there was lead a Bible study, and I talked about the early church in Acts and how they all devoted themselves to the Lord and to their local church, and God blessed it over and over and over. And one thing they did was they met each other's needs. Any need that they had, they didn't have, because they gave everything to each other within their church. And so I shared about that with this local Bible study they've been going to. It's a group of women who, they told me that they have been meeting, they've been really devoted to each other, and they possibly are going to turn it into a church. And so I was like, you know, I just want to encourage them. Like, this is the simplicity of the gospel, simplicity of the church, and God will bless it. And so I shared that, and they loved it. And at the end, I noticed they had a basket in the middle of the room the whole time that when they would come in, they would put something into it. And it had, like, plantains and rice and just random stuff in this basket. And at the end, turns out they all bring something every week, and then they put all of their names into a little basket, and it's kind of like a little lottery of which member they get to bless that week. And so it was truly a God little moment of, hey, this is exactly what you're doing, and I am blessing it, and these people from America can see how much I'm blessing it. So I didn't offer them anything. I just said, hey, you're already doing what God told you to do, and look at how it's growing. So that was just a really cool moment, but it was all worth it.
So I was on house build for the majority of the week, but what really was the best part of the trip was when I did go on a house visit. We were just walking around, and, like, the conditions were terrible. Like, their houses were like, a room here is their house. And just every time you knock on a door and they open up, it's just the biggest smile. It's like, come into my house. Like, I've never met you, but you can come into my house, and we're going to treat you like you've been here 18 times. And the one house we went into, this lady, it was just one mom. And within 1 year, she had lost three children. And two of them were killed, and one, well, she lost to cancer. But, like, you could not have realized if she didn't tell you. Like, she just had the biggest, like, smile on her face. She was, like, just happy to be there and have somebody in her house to, like, bring her company. And that's what really did it for me. It's, like, we have it so good here, and, like, nothing really can compare. Like, our bad here is nothing compared to their bad there. Like, they're struggling to find food, shelter, like, money, everything, and we're just like, we're so blessed. And, like, I got back home and I went in my room and I was like, oh my gosh, like, I don't know, it's just eye-opening. Like, oof. I just really appreciate it. Like, my parents were both there. I had a sister. Like, I walked in the house. They're hugging me, telling me how much they love me, and they're glad I'm safe. And then, like, kids there, you're finding them in trash cans and dumps and, like, wandering around the street begging for food. It just really changed my whole perspective on, like, life here compared to there. So that was really the best part of it.
Yeah, like he said, like, the joy these people have. We go to their homes, they open up their doors with a big smile and just, come on in, we may stay for a few minutes or maybe an hour. And the people that were leading us to these houses, they were 15, Maddie and Samuel. They were music students with Alex that partners with Hands of Hope. And so these 15-year-old kids are taking us all through the village, and they knew some needs. And it was really encouraging to me to see, like, all the youth just love on these people, and just, I mean, they wouldn't shy. They just shared the love of Jesus with all these people and with the kids and our kids as well. And so we didn't get to go to the volcano because we had that sinkhole happen. So instead, we got to go to an orphanage. And so back up for a minute. So this guy Charlie, if you met him, I wish you could meet Charlie. Everybody fell in love with Charlie, And he just had so much joy. I mean, joy like I've never seen before. And we all just fell in love with him. He was a hoot. So when we talked about going to the orphanage, then David mentions that's where Charlie's from. And we're like, what? And so he shared his story the next night. And it, like, we all ugly cried. I mean, I'll never forget. But his story begins where he was found in the trash and was raised by the orphanage. But his joy, I mean, he could have went all kind of different ways. But here he was. Here he is serving with Hands of Hope and their team. And just the joy was amazing that he had. And what else do I say?
Well, I pretty much stayed on the house build, so I guess about 4 days of that. And what really got me mostly was, you know, for them to build a house for, you know, a family, you know, the conditions are pretty rough. And so the lady they were building the house for, she had a few kids. So she didn't take the house. I think they can hear me. Can you hear me? Oh, so anyway, the lady they were building the house for, she didn't take the house. Her sister didn't have a house. So she gave the house to her sister. So when we were building the house, I had them show me her house. Well, her house consists of 10 walls and a tin roof with a bed. So she gave her house away, and that's what she lives in with her kids. She could have had a house, but she gave it to her sister. And that's what she lives in. So I mean,
so on the first day, we went to home visits, and for me, I'm one of those people where, like, if I'm going to talk to you, I have to be really comfortable with you. And so it was really helped me get out of my comfort zone, because I was really scared to pray, but everybody had to pray, but I was really scared. And then after I did it that first few times, it was easy for me. And I think if I didn't be able to go to those house visits and pray, I would not be able to be up here talking right now. And I think that's one of the main things that really helped me. And then Wednesday at the orphanage, I got to play on this playground with a bunch of kids, and they just all seemed so happy. And like, they didn't even have to understand me to be able to like feel like a connection with me. And so we were running around and playing, and it just amazes me because they don't have a family like I do. Like, I am so loved and I'm so blessed and with everything I have and my family that I have. And then I have, like, so much, and I just take it all for granted. And it's really eye-opening to see that, like, how people actually are, like, in other countries, because we have it so good here. And it's really humbling.
Well, I got to be there for close to a month, so a little longer than the rest of the people on stage. And I have two things. First off is just how happy everybody was there. Like, they had nothing to give, but gave it all. Like, you would walk into their house, and they'd be trying to give you food, showing you how to make tortillas, and just all these different things, but they have nothing for themselves. And they would go buy stuff knowing that somebody, like, they call us gringos, somebody that was calling the gringos was coming to their house, and they was going to try to serve them whenever we were there serving them. They were just trying to bless us with very little that they have. The next thing is just the relationship that I was able to build with the Hands of Hope team. Like, I feel like I truly have a second family down in Guatemala. The hunts were amazing, and I got to spend some time with another church from Faith. And there was this 14-year-old girl. She was sharing her testimony at an orphanage. And she said something that's been stuck with me ever since. Our life isn't meant to be safe, it's meant to be saved. And just being able to step out of your comfort zone and go on a mission trip to another country for a month or even a week is just something that I think everybody needs to experience. And it's just been a huge impact on me and my life, and I'm so grateful for the time I got to spend down there. And DSL for life.
Okay, shouldn't have gone after my kids. So, I mean, I could tell y'all story after story about what we saw there. You know, from Charlie being the most absolute loving, and I'm talking about happy all the time. And, y'all, he didn't have a last name. Didn't have a last name. When he got out, he had to leave the orphanage at 15. He doesn't know his birthday. He had to leave the orphanage at 15. And started working as a trash man and was eating the trash. Got his first apartment, and all he had as a bed was his two bags of clothes. Y'all, I mean, I could just tell it go on and on, and this was the happiest man. He at restaurants, he gets all the food, like leaves leftovers, and if somebody leaves it on another table, he gets them to box it up so he can give it out to people. So they were in the situation that he was in. And it's like if anybody had a reason to be upset or to be angry or to not want to love people, I mean, he has the reason. He was not wanted. His parents threw him in the trash to die. And this man loves. So there's just, I mean, story after story like that we could tell you. But on our first mission trip, Eric challenged us to, if you come back and it doesn't change you and you don't implement it here, it did no good. So I'm going to kind of tell y'all some things that, like, I learned that implemented into our life. The first was, y'all, it rained the whole time. I'm talking about rained. Thankfully, we all were kind of prepared. But I did not hear any of these kids complaining about the rain. I didn't hear anybody complaining about the rain. It didn't make anyone slack off. It didn't make anyone want to change the plans. We just went and did it. And that was pretty big because it was not fun sometimes. You know, and so how many times it rains on a Sunday and the church attendance is down because we can't drive in our cars to the church and walk from the parking lot to the building because it's raining. And they're walking, you know, I mean, it's just, that was one thing that stuck out. And then getting to watch Josh and Taylor and Seth, Olivia and Landon experience their first mission trip. It was incredible just getting to watch Taylor grow in her confidence and being able to speak. I was shocked that she said she'd speak today. Just watching that was just so incredible, and just the fun that everyone had. And Josh going from the angry man to finally being the one that everyone finally got to see his happy side. But when Charlie saw him for the first time, he had just dealt with TSA, which is another glimpse of God that he didn't get arrested through TSA or customs. But but just seeing that experience, and then Landon and Seth, I was actually with Seth when at the lady's house, and it was just, Seth's like one of my own, and just to watch his emotions pour out and pouring into these people, and same with Landon, I mean, just, and then, I mean, of course, your own children, just, Taylor didn't really want to be with me that much, but, and getting to build bunk beds together, and then, and I don't know how well y'all know Hunter, because he is a typical middle child, so he kind of sinks to the back, but watching the confidence that grew and what God allowing him to be able to go for the 3 weeks so before us. And I knew he was having fun when we got one phone call the entire time. One. We got a lot of texts. We got a text when they had an earthquake. Hey, we just had an earthquake. I'm like, that's a phone call, buddy. But just knew that his life was changing. It really has, just seen the confidence that he's built through that. It's just been incredible. And I say that to say, without the church, without you guys, that wouldn't have happened. Golly. The trip was funded by him working, Taylor working at different homes, Noah working, and then he couldn't go, so the other two got to use his money. But if y'all hadn't done these jobs, the odd and end jobs, if y'all hadn't given towards this, that wouldn't have happened for a lot of us up here. This we spend so much time here pouring into other ministries and working that we don't get vacations. We don't get time for our family. So, like, every 2 years we get to go on a mission trip. And I'm like, yes, vacation for mission trip. Walking in the middle of these nasty places is our vacation, and it's our time away. And y'all make that happen, and it's not typical at every church. So I appreciate that, and I thank you, and thank you for the impact you had on our kids. It's been huge. And then the last thing that I took away was something that I can implement here. Y'all saw the jump ropes, right? So, like, we literally took shirts, like T-shirts, and just, like, cut them until they looked like, this was mine, this was a good one. Right, Emery?
That's good, yeah.
So you just cut in a big long strip until you get to like this. And then you take three of the T-shirts and you tie them and make a jump rope. And something that simple, using that, broke the language barrier. You didn't need a translator. You didn't need that. And the kids were so open and receptive after that. They just enjoyed it, had fun. A T-shirt, y'all. How many of these do we throw away? Do we give to Goodwill? How many do we get free thrown at us at a ball game? That means nothing to us. This one still had the tag on it from somewhere. So somebody bought this and never wore it, and then it ended up getting donated. And this was huge for the kids. They had a blast. And it just made me think about really here connecting with people. And in order to do that, you have to find the little things, find a way to connect with them, find a way to break that barrier, because it's different here. It's not language. It's a maybe more of a self-entitlement or just a busyness in America, but finding something and finding a way to break that barrier between us and a lost person or us and someone who needs us, how crucial that is. So that was my main takeaway. And then just getting to be with Charlie. But, you know, I do encourage y'all, if y'all have T-shirts and y'all want to know how to do this or y'all want to give them to us and us do it, this was, to me, one of the coolest things ever that we got to do. And how much fun that the kids had. All right, you're up.
All right. So, going off of what Sarah said, my first experience ever on this trip was getting on an airplane. Like, I've never flown anywhere. If I couldn't drive there, we wasn't going. Not that I was scared, but, like, you can ask Sarah, I get on these planes, and the first thing I'm doing, I was like, where are all the, I'm like, how am I going to protect my family if something goes down on here? And then I'm like, where's all the exits? Got it covered. All right, the inflatable raft thing that's underneath my chair, check, make sure I'm making sure everybody's got one. You know, I'm trying to make sure and get eyes on everybody, all that kind of stuff. All right, so then we get down to Guatemala, and we've been a long day, layovers, all this stuff, and we get in there and get through TSA and all that kind of stuff. And being a bigger guy, they like to check my stuff two or three times. Coy got patted down, checked two or three times, stuff like that. So my patience is running thin. All right. So I'm getting, and she did, she warned me about it. I'm glad she warned me about it, because she wouldn't have warned me about it. I don't know. Anyway, so we get down there, and I finally get through all this stuff, and these ladies are like hollering stuff at me and Spanish, and I'm like, I have no idea what you're saying. All right, so I'm still dealing with all this stuff. So I'm like, where is Hunter at? That's what I was like, where's Hunter? And then I look over there through this glass, plexiglass, and Hunter's over there like this, and Charlie, who is about 5'4", he's going like this right beside Hunter. And I'm like, oh, there's Hunter, you know, wave like that. So later on, I find out when they're waving, Hunter's like, oh, there's my dad. And Charlie says, oh, the angry guy. So we finally get back. And anyway, first few days I was able to go and work on the house build. And that was great to be able to work with the guys that were there and see the families that was affected by it and everything. And just how appreciative they were of just us being there, period. Much less than just, you know, just building a house. You know, like Coy said, these people have absolutely nothing. I'm talking like the size of, like, it might be a 10 by 8 room with a dirt floor, a tin roof, tin walls and sticks holding it all up, and then there might be two full-size beds in there that that 10 people sleep in. And majority of them is women and kids. And every now and then you might go to somewhere, based on my experience down there, you might go somewhere that has a grandfather or somebody like that that's there. So when we went on the house builds and we had the pastor there that was there and his kids and his daughters and everything, and they were just so appreciative. Well, then Sarah, she'd been talking to me leading up to it about how, I can't wait for you to go on a house visit. You went to the house build. I would love for you to be able to go on a house visit. So I'm like, okay. So we get up there and we start going on some of these house visits. And we go to this first house, and we've knocked on a few doors, and some would either be working, they didn't have time or whatever, and we'd keep going to the next one. So we went to this one house. First house we ever went, or I ever got to go to, we go in there. And, that's a different story. All right, so first house I go into, we go in there, and there was a grandmother, granddaughter, and then up above them, up the hill, was the two special needs sons. They were all hers. And then there was a few more granddaughters and daughters that lived there. Different situation. I don't know how many people was living there. Several. So we go in there, and this lady starts talking, and just at first she was like, she seemed kind of hesitant and reserved to just kind of share, like, you know, everything that's going on in her life. And I'm sitting here listening to this, and the translator, she's translating, and they do a phenomenal job. How they listen to what they're saying and talk in English at the same time, I'll never know. But this lady, she starts talking, and she starts talking about how one of the first things she said was that when we asked her if there was anything we could pray for her about, and what was her story. And this lady just starts pouring her heart out. And I had no idea what she was saying, but I didn't have to, because I could just hear the pain and see the pain in her tears that was just rolling down her face. And it was almost like all that had been bottled up for years, and that when we went there and asked her if we could pray for her and if there's anything we could pray for her about, it's almost like she just needed that to be able to get it all out. And she just laid it all out there. And everybody, there wasn't a dry eye in the room. And the thing that caught me off guard was, through it all, the first thing that she asked us to pray for was for the salvation of her husband, who had just left her for another woman. And she had been through so many different things, but the thing that she asked us to pray for wasn't for her. It wasn't for her family. It wasn't for anything. It was for her husband, who had just left her for another woman. And that just, that blew my mind, because my mind would not be in that place probably. I mean, if we're all honest with ourselves, you get hurt and stuff like that. That's probably that'd probably be the last thing I'd be thinking about in that moment. So that was the first house build we went to. Then we went on. We did a few different other ones, and we went to CASA and got to be at the orphanage and spend time with a lot of kids and do different things there. And got to play music with Alex, who does all their music teacher and stuff like there down at the school that they've got. So that was really neat. For a first-time experience, it's unbelievable. It really ain't a whole lot I can add to what everybody's already said. I will say this is one trip we went. It was me, Seth, and Olivia, and Alex. We were doing home visits, and we went to this one house, and the lady, we went in there, and the stove was not vented out the roof. So when they would turn it on, all the smoke from the stove would just fill the whole house up, which was tiny. There's kids running around everywhere in there.
and she's just, you know, in there as well. So, like, I'm like, I'm going to have to step out. And Coy was with us. And I was like, me and Coy, I was like, I got to step outside. I can't breathe. I'm going to have an asthma attack here on top of Guatemala. I was like, this is not good. I was like, and then I started thinking, I was like, man, how in the world are these kids just in this? And this is just normal. This is normal that these people are just living in these conditions, and they just loving life and appreciative for everything that they have. And then she starts telling us stories about, you know, different things, and that when it rains, her house becomes a river, basically, is what she was telling us, because they're on the mountain, so gravity works naturally, so water comes down the mountain, and her house just happens to be sitting right in the way, so, like, the entire floor just becomes a river of her house. Like, they had to get on the beds, go out and wherever, get away from it, because just the whole, it just floods every time it rains. You know, stuff like that that people go through, and, you know, and like Sarah was saying, you know, it's rainy season there for them there now, and it rained on us every day. But these people, all they talked about was church and family and stuff like that. And then I start to think about, like Sarah said, you know, if it's going to be a storm and raining and stuff like that, we're like, man, I tell you what, roads are going to be wet today, boys. I don't know if we need to go to church this morning. That's what we're thinking here, you know. And then these people are getting up and walking in this mess to church. And it's not, they're walking in mud to this church, up hills, up mountains, taking their families. And so I guess the thing that I got out of all this stuff is a lot to process, and I'm very kind of process-oriented. There's a lot to process for me, and I've been thinking about it ever since we got back. And I guess when you go on a mission trip, you think, okay, well, they're mission people, the Hunts, they're missionaries. Everybody on the Hands of Hope team, they're missionaries. That's their mission field. But you don't have to go to Guatemala to have a mission field. Your mission field can be right where your feet are. And as a man, my mission field, first and foremost, is my house and my wife and my kids. And when I would go to these houses, and I would walk into them, and you'd see the ladies there and kids and no men. It made me think, I'm like, man, what these people would do to have the man in their home, the husband in their home, the father in their home. And he's absent in each one of these circumstances and situations majority of the time. And then I was sitting there thinking, well, how many times have I been absent in my own home, even though I've been there physically? How many times have I been absent as far as having too many things going on and not prioritizing the right way and not putting my family first in situations when I probably should have, because I was pulled in 45 different directions? So I guess if I brought anything home, outside of just seeing God work through the people that went on the mission trip and worked through us and with the people that we were able to have contact with, I guess if I brought anything home, it would just be me talking to myself of what is my mission field and what is the order of my mission fields, because you can have more than one. And how am I allowing God to use me through those and in those mission fields? So I would encourage each one of you to think about that yourself and challenge yourself. You know, I heard the word comfort mentioned a few times by everybody else that's spoken up here. And one thing I've always said is no growth happens in a comfort zone. If you want to grow, you got to make yourself uncomfortable a little bit. If I lift 135 pounds on a bench press over and over and over, I'm not going to get any stronger. Sometimes I got to add a little weight to the bar, make myself uncomfortable just so I can get a little stronger. And I guess that's the thing, is just getting out of your comfort zone, making sure your priorities are right in your own mission fields.
Well, guys, I think that as you can tell from the stories, how it's impacted each and every one of them in a different way. A lot of the stories are similar, But as you can tell, this is our mission field. But sometimes we do, it does us good to go into a different setting to where God can really touch our heart. And so I think that this pretty much witnesses just how God touched each one of them, what they experienced and what they brought home. And you know, as many times I've been over there, every time it changes me. And I know that it's going to change them. And those who were there 2 years ago, it changed them. And they'll just take this and move forward. So last thing before I give it over to Brother Ronnie so we can close. Again, thank you guys for everything, your prayers, your financial support. Again, we will be going again next year. I just talked to Brother Eric 2 days ago, and the schedule is filling up rapidly. So we've already got some dates set over there. So if you would love to go next year, be thinking about it, be praying about it. We'd love for you to go with us again next year. So we go every year, and hopefully God will lay in your heart to come with us. One person I'd like to acknowledge while we're here. Emery, could you do me a favor? Come here. I know I'm going to embarrass her. I'm sorry, too. Emery Hutto, come on up. Come on. I'm sorry. guys, this is Emery Hutto. She is from Florence. She was Hands of Hope's summer intern. She did a three-week stint there in Guatemala with Brother Eric and them in the mission house. She got the mission out going. She was doing everything from cooking to cleaning to making sure that the mission team got everything they needed. So if you would you do me a favor? It's girls like this and people like this that make it happen.
Thank you, sir. I love you.
So she's one of our interns. We have two other interns come in this summer to help. And so if any of you college age or young adults, college and career, would love to do an internship over in Guatemala with Hands of Hope, man, please reach out to the church or reach out to me. We're more than happy to get you set up for that. And again, on behalf of everybody on the team, thank you guys for your prayers and your support. And we look forward to bringing this to you next year again. Brother Ronnie, it's all yours, brother.
Who going yet?
That's it. That's Alex.
Okay.
That's Hope Academy.
Yes.
And so we got to go to Hope Academy. We got to see Hope Academy.
Wow.
We have about 50 students. He's teaching Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. He's teaching music, English, and Bible study.
Wow.
Yep. And matter of fact, the women's Bible study that they talked about is being held at the school, at Hope Academy.
Academy. Man, we partnered with Eric. Eric and I, when he was home, mentioned, and we just got to talking about a school. And Eric said, man, in my opinion, if you're going to touch a society, you got to start young, because many of the older people, not being disparaging, but they've already said that it's going to be hard to change their way of thinking. I said, Eric, what if we started with the younger people? And so he said, well, I've been thinking about starting an academy. So you may not be aware of this, but our church in March, April, somewhere in there, we doubled our support so that Eric could rent the school. And so we have since started Hope Academy. And so I just want you to know, you said, man, little Killing, Alabama, we're starting stuff in Guatemala for the glory of God. Amen. So you are doing that. You are doing that. Hope Academy. And then all the other stuff that they're doing is because of the love, support, and help that you give. So listen carefully. Thank you for what you do. Pray for them. I'd encourage you. I hate to say it's an easy mission trip, but it's as close as you just about can go. You're safe there. The food can be a little bit difficult for some people who love their mama's cooking too much. So anyhow, but it is. It's something that if you want to do, let me encourage you, okay? Hey, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. You're here today, and I was at a service last Sunday while I was gone. I tried to attend service every Sunday. Last Sunday, I got to watch a young man walk down the church aisle. He's 23 years old, and he committed his life to full-time missions. Wow. Maybe God's calling you. Get out of your comfort zone. Pray about it next year, would you? Get on a plane. Go somewhere where you're going to see people who live in horrible conditions, but they're thankful for their blessings. Maybe you want to do that. Father, we pray for Hands of Hope. We also have Missions of Mercy that we support in Guatemala. So, Lord, I don't thank you for a local church here way in little Alabama that is touching the world. I don't thank you for every dime, every dollar, every hand, every nail, every meal we serve, every Bible lesson we teach will bring glory to your name. Jesus said, I must be about my Father's business. And I pray that's what we are. So, Father, thank you again for this team, for their faithfulness to do what they've done. In Jesus' name. And all the church said, hey, if you have questions for Dave or the team, you can ask them. Hey, at 10 o'clock, we showed a video about the Southern Baptist Convention. If you have questions about that, we can find you the link. I know Pastor Kip knows how to do that. If you would like to watch the new executive director talk about the convention, where we are and things that are going on, see Kip. He'll be able to do that for you. Hey, one more time, would you thank God for our team, what they did? Do it.
One last thing about the Hope Academy. Alex is our, he's the music instructor, and he did ask, they're in need of musical instruments. If you have a musical instrument, any type of musical instrument that you'd love to donate, and we'll get it over to Guatemala, no problems whatsoever, but he is in need of musical instruments. He's got 50 students right now, so just be in prayer for that. And thank you again for your support.
And one thing to go along with that, if anybody going on musical instruments, even something as simple as guitar strings, picks, guitar capos, tuners, anything like that, I mean, all that stuff's less than $20 if you buy it brand new. So anything like that would go a long way because they don't have UPS, they don't have FedEx, they don't have any of that stuff to be able to get those types of things. So the only way they can get it is if a mission team comes in or something like that and just brings it to them. So, do what? Well, any brand would do. So, but yeah, just keep that in mind if you're ever out and about and just happen to see something. Have we got time for one funny story real quick? I know my dad's a Baptist preacher, and apparently I've got those genetics because I talked for like 15 minutes a minute ago and didn't even realize it. So I apologize for that. But so it may be better for one of y'all to tell us. So Miss Mary's down here. She was working on her comfort zone as far as praying in front of people while we're on this trip. We're making bunk beds, all this other stuff. We plop down out in the middle of this road, and we're all eating peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, waiting to go back to work. And I guess through years of playing music and just different things like that and just age, I've got to where I can't hear certain voice levels and tones as well as others. So Miss Mary, she's all, you know, real sweet and quiet, and she's praying and all this other stuff, and I'm like doing one of these, like.
Hold on, you didn't tell the main part.
You tell the main part then.
Before she prayed, she said, well, I'll do it because I need to practice anyways. I need to get out of my comfort zone, and I'm not comfortable with praying. It's not something I'm good at. Okay. No,
all right. So I'm like, okay, well, this is good. Miss Mary's going to work on praying in front of people, getting out of her comfort zone. So she's just praying and she's doing a phenomenal job praying and getting out of her comfort zone. And I'm like, has anybody else can relate to this, especially guys, older women, where you like you do one of them one eye open type things to see are they still praying or are they not? You know, one of them types. That's what I'm doing. But I'm doing it up top, on top of the hill, looking down. There's other people between us, and I can't tell what's going on. Well, I thought she says amen. And I go, amen.
Louder than that.
And I look around, and everybody else they raise their head up, and they look around at me, and they're like, why did he say that? Apparently, she was not done praying, and she had said and I thought she said amen, and it was a bad deal. They let me hear about that the rest of the week. So, yeah, it was funny.
He, like, screamed it, though, like, screamed amen. Like, all right, Mary, you're done.
Look,
no more praying for you.
The air's thinner up there in Guatemala. The sound travels a lot easier, so I really didn't say it that loud. What was you about to say?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Seth, you want to tell the coffee story?
Time to go, man.
So Coy has coined the nickname.
he got the nickname Uncle C in Guatemala.
So we were sitting, we're in a meeting, deciding what the plan is for the next day. And Mr. David asked if we wanted to go to Casa or we could go to a coffee plantation. They could give us a tour of what goes on there. And Uncle C is in the back and he goes, I ain't come here for no coffee tour. That's just my 2 cents. I'm going to go to Casa. I ain't come to Guatemala to go no coffee tour.
So, as you can tell, we did have some laughs. We had a lot of cries and a lot of laughs. We really had a really good time over there. So, yeah. And as Coy says, I didn't come to Guatemala for an old dadgum coffee tour. All right, guys. Again, thank you again for your support. Thank you for your prayers. And, again, y'all have a great day and a great week. God bless you.